As the candidates fly from state to state, the job numbers are going down, the stock market takes a dive. Sometimes it seems the only thing going up is the debt. This is the CitizenLink Report. I'm Stuart Shepard along with Tom Minery, the Executive Director of CitizenLink. Hi, Tom.
Hi, Stuart.
Tom, we usually talk about the importance of social issues here, and we spend a lot of time on those, but this election also is heavily focused on the economy.
Well, it is, and a lot of what the economy represents is family health, and unless the politicians get it right, family income is going to suffer for a number of reasons. You know, the first thing is the unemployment rate. That is also going up. We had a very shocking report last week that showed that the unemployment rate, which had been going down, is now going the other direction. It went from 8.1% up to 8.2%. That is not a good sign. And some commentators say, yes, it would be a lot worse if the pool of job seekers had been the same as it was at the start of President Obama's administration.
Which means a lot of people have given up looking for jobs.
That's right. One way to have the unemployment numbers go down is for people to give up looking and not report to the unemployment office, just give up.
Yeah.
So they're off the unemployment rolls. But if the pool had been as large as it was in 2009, the unemployment rate would be over 11% now.
Now, why is the unemployment number going up? What's your best estimation?
I think a lot of employers are really scared because they do not know what lies ahead. A whole lot of economic policy issues have been kicked to beyond the election. The politicians on both sides have agreed not to deal with hard questions before the presidential election and the congressional election in 2012.
Now, it's easy for us sitting out here to say, well, you know, it would really be helpful if people in Congress would make the tough decisions, would actually get together to challenge some of the problems that are going on with the debt and with the spending that's above what the income is at the government level. But yet it's historically political that this gets pushed along. Nobody really wants to deal with it because it's so much easier to criticize those who want to do the responsible adult thing than it is to actually do something.
And it's also easier to give the appearance of wanting to do something without actually doing it. For example, over the years, politicians in Washington talk about, well, we've cut the budget. Well, they haven't really. They don't ever cut the budget. What they do is cut the rate of increase. In other words, if I want a 10% increase for my agency and the politicians say, no, you get a 7% increase in your agency, then they'll be able to tell the folks back home, see, I cut that budget by 3%.
Yeah.
So, and what is lying ahead, Stuart, is very, very ominous. And you can see when we go through these numbers why it is that employers are having such a hard time. For one thing, the Bush tax cuts are set to either expire right after the election because they pushed off a decision on whether to continue these tax cuts or whether to raise taxes to the level they were before President Bush took office in 2001. Yeah. Well, what does all that mean? That means this.
Yeah, help us understand it.
The tax rates instituted by President Bush have meant that if you're a single wage earner, you began saving $1,600 by paying that much less in income taxes. So it was a boon. Now, if the tax cuts expire, suddenly, that single wage earner making $80,000 a year is going to have to fork out $1,600 more in taxes. Well, that's a big jump. For married people, it's even worse. And if the Bush tax cuts are allowed to expire, that means tax rates for married people go up even at a higher rate than for single earners. For example, a married couple with household income of $80,000 would pay an additional $2,200 to the federal government in federal taxes. So it's a penalty to be married as opposed to two people living independently together, cohabiting. And we have noted that throughout the years that they ought to have an inducement for people to commit to each other and get married. So naughty decisions about what to do. And the decisions have been put off until after the election because the two sides are far apart and getting farther apart. For example, President Obama believes that increasing the size of the federal government is the answer to productivity. You can put more people to work by increasing government grants to hire more teachers, hire more police officers. The conservatives say, you got to be kidding, because we got to borrow 40 cents of every dollar that the federal government spends. That makes no sense. And President Obama, your $800 billion stimulus has been a failure. And there's some evidence to that. Late last year, the Congressional Budget Office said that, well, that $840 billion stimulus package that the president forced through Congress and the Democrats forced when they had the upper hand has created about 700,000 jobs. Now, that may sound like a lot, but that's $1.2 million per job. It would have been better just to give 700,000 people $1.2 million because they would have spent it and put it into the economy. I'm kind of rambling here, but that's only one of the problems or something else.
You talked about those jobs too. They aren't careers necessarily. They're jobs for a set period of time and then you're on your own again.
You know, you're absolutely right, and that's a good thing to point out. I remember there was a bill signing ceremony for the stimulus, and one of the people who was there with President Obama was a public school teacher who was able to stay on because her school district got a grant for money, and that teacher was laid off the following year because the grant ran out.
Yeah.
And so you can see the disparate beliefs that are separating these two sides.
Now, you talked about how all these decisions are going to have to be made in the very near future after the election is when the calendar has been set for these. And there's a popular book out now which talks about it, and it's kind of the phrases entering the common speak of the rest of us. That is the debt bomb. What is the debt bomb, and why should we be concerned about it?
That's a fascinating look at the combined road ahead toward the cliff that, or the, in Senator Coburn's view, who wrote the book, the debt bomb, this thing is going to explode and our country is going to drizzle away in a heap of debt. Senator Tom Coburn is a very gifted analyst of financial situations and is able to explain those to average people. He has written a new book. He's been at called the debt bomb. As you said, he's been at the center of this debate in the Senate, and it's instructive to read Senator Coburn's book because he lays the blame not only with the liberals, but the conservatives who have, both sides have gone along for so long that they're not even bothering to read these hugely complex spending bills that Congress passes. They're laying it off to career staff people. And he says the problem is not that we disagree in Washington. The problem is that we agree too much. We let all the spending go. Just give me my earmark and my district will be happy. Just you can have your earmark and you vote for this big bill too. Tom Coburn explains this in terms that are very easy to understand. It's a very important book. You know, when we talked about what's happening, what's been kicked down the road, another looming problem is another vote on the debt limit. You recall just last summer there was a big crisis over whether the debt limit should be raised from $14.6 trillion to $16.4 trillion. And last August there was a near shutdown of the federal government, the Tea Party type saying, good, shut it down. Other people said, we can't do that. And so they agreed to raise the debt to $16.4 trillion, and we need to raise it again. That's been kicked down the road to just after the election. So after the election, when you have a lame duck Congress, lots of transitions taking place, perhaps at the White House, perhaps at the leadership of the Senate and the House, they've got to deal with these hugely difficult things. That's why people who otherwise might hire people are very afraid to do it, which is, voila, why the unemployment rate has increased.
And keeps going up. Now, what's interesting about this is the decisions that are made often are made purely on political calculation rather than what's best for families and what's best for the country. Let's talk about the payroll tax just for a second. First, what is it? And then talk about what happened with it.
Every once in a while, people might hear about the payroll tax and the fact that the payroll tax reduction will expire. One of those other things that's going to be, it's been kicked down the road to right after the election. Well, what in the world is the payroll tax? The payroll tax is the tax on your earned income, your paycheck, that goes to paying for Social Security, your future Social Security benefits.
If there are any.
Well, and it's about 6.2% of your income
goes
to your share of the Social Security. That was reduced to 4.2% to give people some relief from high taxes. But when you think about it, when Social Security already is going broke, they just made it grow broke faster by cutting the taxes, which is the only way to increase that pile of money in Social Security. Well, yeah, President Obama says, you Republicans, you want to cut taxes? Let's cut this one, the payroll tax. And the House Republicans had a big tumultuous in-house debate over that. Finally, John Boehner, the Speaker, got enough votes from some Republicans and mostly Democrats, and they passed it because he didn't want President Obama to outflank him on the politics of tax cutting.
Right.
Because the president would say, you didn't go along with this tax cut. We wanted to cut the payroll tax to give wage earners relief. You didn't go along with it. And the conservatives are saying, wait a minute, that's the Social Security. That's the only way we can pay for Social Security. We can't cut that. Anyway, that's the kind of political gobbledygook we're into. And what lies ahead is very unnerving for a lot of people.
And I've heard on more than one occasion the president come out and describe himself as the tax cutter. He's reduced our taxes over the years. But then when you hear the details, it takes on a whole different light.
Well, it does. And so it's all about politics, and people ought to pray for the country.
All right, and we will. Tom, thank you for your insights and for helping us understand some more of this to get an idea of what's at stake this election. And thanks to all of you who've written to let us know your questions, your comments, your criticisms. We appreciate hearing from you. You may always write to us at mail@citizenlink.com. You know, later this month, the Supreme Court is expected to release its historic decision on the president's signature legislation, the health care reform law. Would you take a moment to pray for each of the justices on the Supreme Court personally? It's easy to find their names online. You can look them up. Just take some time and pray for them, that they would have wisdom and clarity, and that they would go beyond the politics of all this and get into what's really constitutional and what's best for the country. And remember, stand tall and be heard.